Tash Dile, and welcome to In Conversation with Tibet TV. This is Sakina Butt. For today's conversation, we will be discussing about Tibetan music and its significance. And to have this discussion, I have with me a researcher on music and dance in Tibet and India, and her name is Professor Anna Morcom. Welcome to the show, Anna.
Thank you.
So Anna, tell us, how and when did you gain interest in Tibetan music, and what made you take up this research?
Well, it all started in 1990. I came to Dharamsala. I was at Tipa as an Inchi Gege English teacher. I didn't know anything about Tibetan music or ethnomusicology. Well, I was not thinking to be an academic. So I was there for 6 months with a friend teaching English, and I listened to so much music, and I became incredibly attached, you know, to the music. I absolutely loved it, and started to learn some songs, Tibetan songs, Damnyen. And then after, I gradually in various ways followed it up. So it changed the course of my life.
So it all started from the 1990s?
It all started from 1990.
And since then you started your research?
Well, I only started doing actual research on Tibetan music in 2002. But before that, I studied Indian music, ethnomusicology. I did a PhD on Hindi film songs, Bollywood. And then after, I started actually doing research on Tibetan music. But before that, I used to sing and, you know, so on.
So for how long were you there in Tipa?
6 months.
And that was when you were introduced to the Tibetan music?
Yes.
So what are you working on right now?
I'm working on a project on Indian classical music, Hindustani music. But in terms of Tibetan music, I'm continuing to work on pop music, videos, looking at about how they're sort of portraying, commenting on, interacting with development and also politics. I'm continuing to do that. And I also started to work on the chanting music. Really, I'm looking at the popular style chanting music. You know, when you take some mantras or a part of a prayer and you set it to very slow music, recorded music, so not the actual prayer ceremonies in the monasteries. Pop music, well, in Tibet and exile, you've got two quite different stories. In Tibet, it's a very busy area. You know, there are a lot of singers, a lot of videos, a lot of expression of Tibetan identity. But you also have a lot of the imagery is very glossy. Everything looks perfect. This is also a little bit like the tourist magazines of the state. So I'm trying to look at how these videos and these songs are quite complex. And then you still get some songs where people are really singing protest very directly, and they suffer for it. You know, they get arrested. So I'm looking at the aesthetics and the politics, you could say.
Have you seen some of the musics that are made in exile?
Yes. I mean, I was looking at pop music a long time ago, even, you know, Akama and Rang Tsen Shunu, and now that, you know, Tseringyurme and Purbuti Namgyal, and they're really popular in Tibet. When I was in Tibet last, that was 2007, but they were very popular. So I think Tibetan exile pop music is really incredible, actually, because in exile, out of Tibet, you have about 130,000 Tibetans. So it's a really, really actually a small number. You have this whole infrastructure, but it's still a very small population. People are really spread out. Yet people have created pop music, a lot of really good music. And now if you have I remember in 1990 in London, you go to a Tibetan party. People weren't playing Tibetan pop music then. There wasn't much. A few people would sing Tibetan songs, you know, just sing themselves. And then eventually people would start listening to Hindi music. But now you don't have to have that Hindi sector. You can have the whole night, you can listen to Tibetan pop music. And not just from Tibet. So the exiles have created this really rich scene of popular music on very little resources. So I think it's really incredible.
Do you think that modern Tibetan music is actually a setback in promoting the traditional Tibetan music, or do you think that it is helping to keeping this traditional music alive?
That's a difficult question. I mean, across the world, we see that popular music is replacing traditional music. It's really, really difficult because traditional music has grown out of rural life, you know, and a lot of the music is about, it relates if you are a farmer or a nomad. And now people are not farmers and nomads. In Tibet, some people still are, but in exile, people aren't. So you've got a completely different world. It's related to a different world, and the popular music is speaking out of people's world today. And then we have to remember traditional music was also new once upon a time. So it is in some ways, but I think pop music itself has got a lot of, it's got traditional elements in it. Like Tseren Gyurme, for example, he's woven a lot of traditional elements in it. A lot of singers have. And sometimes, you know, people get curious and they want to learn, or they see in a pop video there's a Dramnyan and they think, you know, I want to learn Dramnyan. So I think it does do this, but you cannot rely on pop music to support traditional music, that's for sure.
You think that it is taking away its authenticity?
It's just it's music from a very different world, and they do conflict. You know, the one does take the place of the other, unless you make a big effort to stop it. That's what I think. In some ways, yes, Tibetan pop music, it uses traditional music, but not in a way that's authentic. No, it's not trying to be traditional music, but it's trying to give a flavor, some continuity, so you can listen to a Tibetan song and say, that sounds like a Tibetan song I can hear because of whether it's the style of the lyrics, or you hear Dramnyan or Piwang, or the kind of melody you have. Maybe it sounds a little like a Bashe or a Doshe, you know. So in these ways, it connects with traditional music, but at the same time, it does replace it, yeah.
So Anna, you have also written a book on Tibetan music, which is called The Unity and Discord.
Unity and Discord, yes.
So can you tell us a little bit about that book?
That was a very general book, looking at how after the 1950s, so after China took hold of Tibet, how that whole situation had impacted musical culture. So you have, for example, the politicization of music. Suddenly you have lots and lots of propaganda songs. Cultural revolution, all traditional music was banned. People just had to constantly sing in praise of the party and socialism and so on. And then also you had the state dance troupes. So the Chinese state has got a whole hierarchical system of song and dance troupes. And they don't just perform political songs saying, you know, the party is good, China is good. It's not just that, it's the style. As I think everyone in exile knows, if you see one of these dance troupes from China, you say, this is very Sinicized, this is very Chinese. It's a very different aesthetic. So they have also changed across China, not just Tibetans. There are so many minorities. So all the music and dance is quite similar. So if you dance, you have to learn ballet. So your basis is ballet. So the whole movement, the whole way people move their bodies in dance is different from if you watch Tipa, for example. So it's a very general book. And also talking about resistance, how are, you know, political songs, because there's a history of political, you know, Tibetans themselves singing songs of protest.
So how important do you think the institution of Tipa is?
I think in exile, Tipa is incredibly important. They have done with very little resources. Now it's better, but for very little resources. You can always say, oh, it's impossible to preserve traditional performing arts. We know that. It is impossible to preserve because things always change. So the kind of song and dances Tipa are doing, they used to be done by nomads and farmers who were not professionals. They were not on stage. They did not all look pretty, you know. So there are many changes Tipa have made, but at the same time, they have preserved a real, like the voice, the Tibetan voice, you know, the kind of vocal, the kind of singing style, they've preserved that. And the kind of dance style, the sort of movements. And you can see now, not just in, you know, in Dharamsala or India and Nepal, but in America, there are so many ex-Tipa there. They're teaching in Sunday schools, they're teaching kids there, they're learning Dramnyan songs and so on. So you can really see that the Tipa have ensured that there is some kind of basis in exile of these traditions. Otherwise, I mean, exile, it was the most incredible, you know, change, disruption, you know, a traumatic break, leaving Tibet and having to come to India, completely different world, different weather, different language and so on. And in the midst, you have these traditions that are there. And so I think Tipa really feeds this. And they've also done, you know, some really good pop music has also come out of Tipa as well. So I think they're an incredibly important institution, and I hope to see them, you know, go from strength to strength.
So in an exile community like that of Tibetans, what kind of importance does music hold politically?
Music is always important politically. You can never say this music is not political. It depends how, what do you think politics is? Politics is very broad. So it's not just songs singing like, you know, we want freedom or something. It's talking about a way of life as well, or it is very, very broad, especially because exile is facing what's happening in China. And I think it is very important for, I mean, this is not for me to say, this is for, you know, you all as Tibetans to say, but for a group of people to have their own music. Otherwise, imagine if all you had to sing was Indian songs or English songs and dances. You know, Tipa, for example, and also other Tibetan singers, they are like ambassadors for exile Tibet. So it's very powerful, and I think music is very powerful politically, because often you don't realize it's political. You think, oh, this is just nice music, but actually it goes into you and it has many meanings. And in China, they were very, very aware of this. You know, Mao Zedong, back in the 40s, they understood 100% the political power of performing arts and culture. And that's why they spend so much resources in building these dance troupes, and, you know, so you can see the importance they place on politics, and not just them, across the world, you know, the importance of any kind of nation or nation in exile to have their own kind of music and dance.
So, Anna, it was lovely doing this conversation with you. Thank you so much for being in our show.
Thank you so much. Likewise. Thank you.
Thank you so much for watching, and see you in the next episode of In Conversation with Tibet TV.